At some point, I think we've all seen a big, beautiful display vivarium at a zoo, housing multiple dart frog species of all different colors living together. And many of us have thought, wow, I would like to build something similar. But if you've ever shared these plans on a forum or in a Facebook group, chances are you've quickly been told that housing different kinds of dart frogs together is a bad idea for various reasons. However, while a big part of the community is entirely against mixing species, there are also a lot of experienced keepers out there who think it's doable in many cases. Today, I'll try to thoroughly explain why I, along with almost all experienced dart frog keepers, think that mixing dart frogs is often a bad idea, whether that be different species or different localities and color variants of the same species. However, I will also be looking into the cases where it can have a good chance of actually working out. I'm a firm believer that mixing species can be done safely if it's done in the right way, and I've had a few successful mixed vivariums myself. Throughout the video, I'll be focusing on keeping different dart frog species together long term, but towards the end, I will also talk about keeping dart frogs with other animals and about raising froglets of different species together. But before we get into that, I want to mention that the comment section is always open and I would love to see and participate in some discussion there, as long as you keep a good tone. I would also really appreciate it if you could subscribe to the channel, since only a small percentage of my viewers are actually subscribed. It's completely free and you can always unsubscribe later if you change your mind. Now, let's get back to the question. Can you keep different dart frog species together? To answer that, I've put together a list of problems you can run into while mixing dart frog species, and I'll go through these issues while discussing the possibilities of avoiding and minimizing them. The most common argument against mixing species or different localities of the same species is the fact that dart frogs can crossbreed and hybridize, which pretty much all experienced dart frog keepers want to avoid. This is because the different frogs you see in captivity aren't actually morphs spread by us humans, like different ball python morphs, but they're actually different varieties, or as we call them, localities, deriving from different populations in the wild. The exact same species can look completely different in different areas in nature. These populations are often very small and vulnerable, which is why we want to preserve them in the hobby in case some of them were to go extinct in the wild. If you keep different locales of the same species together, for example, Dendrobates tinctorius acerius with Dendrobates tinctorius Brazil, then there's a high likelihood that they will start breeding and produce crossbred offspring. Down the line, if these crossbreeds would get out on the market and accidentally get mislabeled as a pure line, this could harm the populations that basically the entire dart frog hobby unanimously strives to preserve, and we would end up losing track of what we have. This has apparently already happened with certain aquarium fish, I believe, where species are so hybridized that nobody knows which is which in the general trade anymore, and we want to avoid getting to that point. Nature has already provided us with plenty of beautiful frogs, so there's no need to create more and risk losing track of what we have. Similarly, some dart frogs of entirely different species can also produce hybrids. Sure, the basic scientific definition of a single species is that they can get fertile offspring with each other, and if they're different species, that means they can't. But in practice, that's rarely the case, as our classifications are quite messy at times, especially when it comes to amphibians, and many dart frog species have actually been proven to be capable of producing fertile hybrid offspring with other frogs in their genus. Even if you're not planning on breeding your frogs, then first of all, what are you doing? You would be missing out on a ton of fun. And second of all, there's a risk that they will do so regardless, and a few tadpoles might go unnoticed and survive in the vivarium to become froglets. Now, I 100% understand and agree with the strive to preserve the natural localities in the hobby and not start crossing them. But it's strange to me that this is the main argument against mixing species, since hybrids and crossbreeds are very easy to avoid. There are two reliable ways to do that. The first one is only keep males or only keep females, though I personally wouldn't go for this option since you miss out on the breeding aspect, and it's usually hard to determine the gender of your frogs unless they're calling males. However, the second way to avoid crossbreeds and hybrids in a mixed vivarium, and the way that I prefer, is to stick to mixing species that aren't closely related. I said there's a risk for fertile hybrids if you mix closely related species, since we might be wrong about our classifications. But if you go for an entirely different genre, such as keeping a Ranitomeia with a Dendrobates instead of two different Dendrobates together, then you will definitely be fine in that regard. And also, if you make completely sure that any potential hybrid frogs stay with you for their entire lifespan and won't be sold to random hobbyists with the risk of eventually getting mislabeled, then I definitely won't be the one to sit here and harass you about how you're ruining the entire dartfrog hobby or something like that. Though there are a few people in the dartfrog community who might do so, so a friendly piece of advice is to not share it on Facebook. The second thing you have to account for is territorial behavior and bullying. Dartfrogs might look cute and friendly, but they can be very aggressive at times. In some cases, even keeping multiple same-gendered frogs of the same species together can be problematic. And when you're mixing entirely different species, these problems can increase and severe bullying can occur. There are many cases where Ranitomea imitators and Ophaga pomelio have wrestled with some much bigger Dendrobates species, and I've also heard about a case where a Dendrobates cinctorius suffocated smaller tank mates in the substrate. Not only can these occurrences be lethal, but they're obviously also very stressful for the frogs even when it doesn't lead to their death. This is also something that can change over a period of time. For example, Dendrobates cinctorius females can be very calm for the first year or two of their lifespan, but then just change and start fighting all the other frogs all of a sudden. In my opinion, this is honestly the main reason why we usually don't recommend mixing to new keepers. If there are any problems, you need to be able to spot it and separate the frogs in time. You also need to have kind of a gut feeling for the species you want to mix and how they work, so you will know if they have a good chance of being compatible or not, and know what to look out for. And that gut feeling is something that comes from experience, keeping your frogs and watching their behavior over an extended period of time. There are three things you can do to avoid a problem with bullying. I recommend doing all of these three things, but sometimes you can get away with only two of them if you really know your frogs and know what you're doing. The first thing you should do is to choose group-friendly species. As I mentioned earlier, some species are real troublemakers, so for that reason I would avoid or at least be very careful with keeping Dendrobates tinctorius, Ophaga pomelio, or Ranitomea imitator together with any other species, unless the vivarium is extremely big. And I'm sure there are a few more species out there that would fit on the avoid list. However, there are plenty of species which are simply less territorial and can work well in big groups and in mixed vivariums, such as Dendrobates leucomelas, Dendrobates auradus, all phylobates species, all epipedobates species, and many Ranitomea species. In general, the frog species that basically always do well in big groups without issues usually also do fairly well with other species, while the ones that can sometimes be problematic in groups are often also problematic in mixed settings. Of course, there's still no guarantee, because there are cases where even friendly species have wrestled with tank mates, and in that case, you have to be ready to separate them. The second thing you can do to minimize bullying and stress is to choose species that occupy different areas of the vivarium. If you keep, let's say, a terrestrial Dendrobates species with an arboreal Ranitomea species, they aren't really going to interact as much as if you kept two terrestrial or two arboreal species together. Third, you should have a pretty large vivarium. In the wild, these animals would have an infinite amount of room to get away from each other during any territorial disputes, and the frogs usually live in a far lower density in the wild compared to our quite crowded vivariums. When you're thinking about the required enclosure size for multiple species living together, you should think 1 plus 1 equals 4. Of course, that's not an exact formula that will always apply, it depends on the species, but the general mindset you should have is to provide plenty of room instead of just adding up their individual minimum space requirements. It's also good to try to create different rooms in the vivarium, with some kind of plant or hardscape barriers, so the frogs can get away from each other without seeing each other. Another issue you can run into when keeping different species together is competition for food. If you were to keep a dendrobates cinctorius, which is known to be a very voracious eater, together with a shy Ranitomea species, then there's a high risk that the tinctorius will eat all the fruit flies before the Ranitomea even dares to come out, resulting in a fat tinctorius and a skinny Ranitomea. This can vary both between species and between individuals of the same species, and it can also depend on the vivarium, the hardscape and planting, how many different places you're able to feed in, how stable the microfauna in your vivarium is, and so on. What works for someone might not work for someone else. So this comes back to the gut feeling I talked about before. Experience with the frogs in question is a key thing when considering if they could do well together in a specific vivarium. This of course isn't a reason why mixing can never work, it's just something that you need to look out for. If you see a frog losing weight, that could be because it's being bullied or because it can't keep up with the other frogs at feeding time, and in either case they need to be separated. But simply trying to mix species that are equally bold during feeding time and being ready to separate them if there are any issues would be enough to counter this problem. For some species combinations, you run a risk of one frog straight up eating another. Most art frogs, even some of the bigger ones, prefer very small prey items like fruit flies and springtails. It's very strange how an adult dendrobates will just sit there eating tiny springtails for hours, while most normal frogs of that size would just eat one adult cricket instead. However, some dart frogs can actually take on slightly larger prey items. One of them is Phyllobates terribilis, and I believe the same thing would go for Phyllobates bicolora and some of the bigger Amerega species. Keeping one of those with a tiny Ranitomea species might mean a risk that the Ranitomea would get eaten. There really aren't many dart frogs that could potentially eat smaller frogs, but be aware of the exceptions and avoid keeping those with any of the really tiny species. Something else you always have to consider when you're keeping different animals together is their respective climate requirements. This is something that's not as relevant when you're mixing different dart frog species as when you're mixing other reptiles and amphibians, since most of us keep most of our dart frogs in pretty much the same way, at least as far as the climate is concerned. With that said, there are certain dart frog species out there that might prefer slightly different temperatures or moisture levels than others, and in that case, you either have to have a very large vivarium where you can provide all the necessary microclimates, or just take the easy route and keep them separately. The sixth and final argument against mixing species that I will bring up is the risk for spreading diseases, parasites and pathogens. This is a very real problem that you can run into, and even though the risk is fairly small, the consequences could be very dangerous. You don't want to spread anything bad within your frog room, and you most definitely don't want to spread something from your frog room to the wild amphibians in nature, with the latter being something I believe we all need to think more about. But while I think this is something important to be aware about, I believe the risk for spreading something that hasn't already been spread is very small, with animals that have been captive bred for generations upon generations. Even if I didn't have any mixed vivariums, my frogs would still be kept in vivariums right next to each other, with cuttings transferred between them all the time, substrate from one used to kickstart the microfauna in another, and occasionally even the same vivarium being used for different frogs at different points in time without being cleaned out in between. I normally dislike the argument of, well, nothing's gone wrong, so that means it's safe. But with proper quarantine for new frogs, I think the risk is very small, and barely increases by keeping two species together. Personally, I would never mix any frogs that are bought from sketchy sellers or wild-caught frogs, but aside from that, I don't think there is a significant risk if you buy your frogs from trustworthy sellers and quarantine them properly. I've had a few mixed vivariums myself. The one I've had for the longest is a tank where I kept Phyllobates vitatus and Ranitomea amazonica French Guiana for almost 3 years. They bred and culled constantly, and I never saw the two species even touching each other, aside from being close to one another during feeding time. They fulfill all the criteria I've mentioned throughout the video, as they're a group-friendly species that can't hybridize, and both are equally active during feeding time. The enclosure was huge, as it was the biggest Exoterra, so they had plenty of space. The reason I separated them wasn't because I ran into any issues with the cohabitation. It was only because I wanted that vivarium for my growing Epipodobates anthoniae colony. For a while, I also used to keep an Epipodobates anthoniae male with my Phyllobates vitatus group without any issues. It was only temporary, and I didn't keep them together for a time long enough to call it a definitive success, but I'm quite confident that it would have worked out long term, and many other keepers have also kept Epipodobates and Phyllobates together successfully. An instance where I frequently mix species is when I raise my froglets. Since froglets are too young to reproduce, there is no risk for hybrids, and they're also not territorial at that age, so there isn't much bullying. Therefore, you can actually mix froglets from species that shouldn't be kept together permanently, and you don't need as much room for them. For example, I raise Leucomelus froglets and Tinctorius froglets together, even though I would never recommend keeping them together as adults due to their risk for hybrids and the fact that Tinctorius are real troublemakers. I much prefer separating my froglets by size rather than by species to make sure the younger ones can start growing properly without competition from any much older tank mates. Of course, I could keep them separated by both size and by species, but I just really don't see any need for that. Something I've not really touched on in this video is the option of keeping dart frogs together with other animals. The most common combination is keeping dart frogs together with mourning geckos, and that's something I would even feel relatively confident recommending to a beginner. Though there can be issues if you keep mourning geckos with thumbnail frogs, as the geckos might be able to hurt the tiny frogs, and large dart frogs like Phyllobates terribilis can actually try to eat the geckos. Some other small geckos, such as Gonatodes, Sparrowdactylus, and some of the smaller Felsuma species, can also be kept with dart frogs if you have a large vivarium where you can fulfill both species' respective climate requirements. I've kept Hemidactylus platyurus with dart frogs in the past, and it works. However, the geckos need a hotspot which is too hot for the frogs, so you need a very large vivarium with room for both enough hotter areas for the geckos and enough colder, more humid microclimates for the frogs. You can honestly go on like this discussing different possible combinations for days, but I think I would rather move on to the conclusion. A very common quote, which could almost have replaced this entire video, goes as follows. If you have to ask if two different species can be kept together, you should not attempt mixing them because you don't understand their care requirements enough to do so and do not have the experience needed to identify the problems that may develop in a mixed vivarium. This pretty much sums up my opinion and this entire video in a single sentence. A big vivarium with different animal species all living together is a fascinating concept, and I totally understand the urge to have one. But you have to remember that it doesn't benefit your frogs in any way, and it's only for your own personal enjoyment. The reasons against it are also quite strong, even though it's possible to get around them by carefully planning out which species to keep together and providing them with plenty of room. Keeping different species of dart frogs together is not something I would normally recommend to a beginner, but I absolutely think it can be done safely if it's done in the right way. Now, that's it for today's video. If you enjoyed it, make sure to subscribe to the channel and press the notification bell so you won't miss out on any future uploads. Feel free to also share the video with a couple of people, as it's a great way for you to support me. Do you agree with my opinion about mixing species, or do you think that it's a big no-no? Please let me know about your opinion and experiences in the comment section down below. If you want to see more of my animal room, feel free to follow me on my Instagram at gecko_geek06. Thank you for watching.